Dear friends,
it should be recording.
Flo's family has asked that we begin our service of memorial with a song that reminds her of the best times of her life and that might engender each and every one of us to remember our own memories of this dear and loving human being, Flo Dobrin.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just fly and start. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you soon. You may hear angels cheer, cause we're together, weather-wise, it's such a lonely day. Just say the words, and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. Perfect for flying honeymoon, they said. Come fly with me, let's fly away.
I know you're all wearing masks, but I can see your smiles. And in Sinatra's words, I pray that angels are cheering Flo on. El Harachaman, O sweet God, you've taken a beloved one from us. We gather and grieve in a world darkened by Flo's loss. But her love that united us in life, death cannot sever. Her companionship shared along life's path, which continues now through the tenderness of good memories. The gifts of her heart, her mind, for decency. These brought us joy and happiness that endures. For all these and more, we give thanks to you, O God. Adonai mi yagur ba'ohalecha mi yishkon b'har kodshecha. God who abides in your house, who dwells in your mountain. Those who are upright, who do justly, who speak the truth in their hearts, who do not slander others or wrong them or bring shame upon them, who scorn the lawless, but honor those who revere God, who give their word and come what may do not retract, who do not exploit others, who would never take bribes. Those who live in this way, the way in which our Flo lived, they shall never, ever be shaken. Amen.
Eli. Lo yigamer leolam ha'chol v'chayam rishrosh shel ha'mayim berak ha'shamayim tfilat ha'adam. God, my
my God, I pray that these things never end. The sand and the sea, the rush of the waters, the crash of the heavens, the prayer of the heart, the sand and the sea, the rush of the waters, the crash of the heavens, the prayer of my heart.
Grandma. A little over a month ago, I celebrated my birthday, and I was having, quite honestly, the worst birthday I have ever had. I won't go into the details, but towards the afternoon, I ended up deciding to just lay in bed and sleep it off. While I was laying there, upset, trying to fall asleep, my phone kept ringing. I ignored it twice. On the third ring, I figured I'd at least look at it to see who was calling. The screen said, Grandma and Grandpa, home. I answered quickly, Hi, Grandma. For the next several minutes, I laid in bed with a huge smile on my face. Your call made my day. You sang me three different songs and asked me questions about life and what I was doing these days. And I got to ask you some questions and listen to what you had to say. In the past few years, our conversations were not as long as they used to be. Your memory wasn't as strong, and after a short while, you'd usually want to get off the phone. But not that day. That day felt different and special. For a moment, it felt like those Saturday afternoons growing up, when you and Grandpa would call us on the kibbutz, and we would take turns talking to you. Those conversations were sacred to us, and as I got older, I realized how special and non-trivial they were, and how your dedication to staying so close to us shaped us into who we are today. When I think of you, Grandma, so many things come to mind. The first thing on the list is obviously chocolate. Your love to chocolate has definitely trickled down into our genes because some of us seem to have the same obsession. You appreciated good food and beautiful things, and you had a great taste. You always wanted to look your best, and even when you weren't quite sure what day it was, you always remembered to put your makeup on and assemble the perfect outfit for whatever the occasion. You taught me how to be a lady in a house full of boys. You taught me how to balance my checkbook. You taught me so many other things that I won't mention here, but I hope I remember them all forever. In your way of life, you taught us kindness and unconditional love. You and Grandpa were such a big part of our lives. You made it your goal to always make us feel loved and welcome, no matter the distance between us. I cannot even imagine how difficult and heartbreaking it must have been for you two to lose a daughter. We were lucky to have you as our grandparents. With every little thing you said and did, you kept our connection to her alive. Your love and unique connection to Israel and our kibbutz, and the special bond you built with our father and his side of our family. The outpour of love from all of them in the past few days has showed us how truly amazing and kind both you and Grandpa were to everyone around you. Both of you were such active members in your community. You've gathered around you so many good friends, friends who were always like family to us. In fact, growing up, I actually thought that some of them were our relatives. You did so many wonderful things throughout your long and full life. You raised a family and had children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. You were dedicated to so many projects and organizations. You were a true leader and an inspiration for so many people. But for us, you were always simply our Savta, and that was the best thing in the world. I hope that wherever it is that you're going now, it's peaceful and beautiful. I hope you're eating all the chocolate you want without feeling guilty and tap dancing with Frank Sinatra himself. And I hope you get together with your father and mother, with Grandpa Dick, and with your daughter, our mother, Jill. Wherever it is that you're going, know that we feel so lucky to have had you as our grandma. And I am so, so happy that I answered the phone that day. Her beneshikot lehitraot, grandma.
What a beautiful tribute. We should all only live so that our grandchildren can speak of us with such honor, love, and appreciation. Thank you. Dear friends, one of my favorite teachings about the values that we gather during our lifetimes is that they are akin to the verses in a Torah scroll, like the ones in the Aron HaKodesh, the Ark, in every synagogue around the world. The teaching explains that through the choices you make and the words you speak, you are writing a scroll, as sacred as the one the Israelites received from their ancestors, that continue to be poured over for meaning day after day. Many of you know, though, that the book of Deuteronomy does not conclude with a happily ever after moment. It ends with the death and a eulogy to Moses, who in his case dies before he realizes his life's dreams. Only then are his children and all the Israelites left with the task of carrying on in his memory the first few biblical verses after the end of Torah. Joshua chapter 1 in verse 8 says, Lo yamush sefer ha-Torah hazeh mipicha. Do not let this book depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. Take care of all that is written in it. Then you shall be successful. Then you shall do well. Joshua continues, Have I not enjoined you? Chazak ve'amatz, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, for I am with you wherever you go. I believe these words are most appropriate when we reflect back on the teachings that Florence Dobrin has left to us. For as we mourn her, it is natural to wonder how we'll find the strength and courage to reach out to others and to God for help at this time of loss. I would suggest that with the affection Flo carried for those around her, so beautifully illustrated just a moment ago by Maya's sweet and loving eulogy, that those are gifts that she carried with her unto her dying breath. I knew Flo Dobrin for the last 10 years of her life. I feel I knew her well. But just in the time I've spent with Diane the other day on the phone, and in the numerous messages that friends of hers and friends of Jill's and Diane's that have posted their tributes online, I've begun to hope that I might have absorbed some of the essence of her values. For it seems to me that the teaching that she kept closest to her heart was to do what was right, to choose what was right, to keep learning and expanding, to test the fiber of her character, and to laugh at what she had no control over. That is what she'd be doing right now if she were sitting here amongst us as we mourned a different person. So let us fill our hearts right now with an appreciation for the honor, the courage, that she carried on, and her strength that did not abate, not once in her life. Her chazak, her amatz, they are very much with us. When Flo passed away this past Friday, July 31st, it marked a complete circle to her having been born nearly 92 years ago here in Cleveland on October 4th. She was the only child of Morris, a Polish immigrant who owned a local funeral supply business. And her mother, Johanna Lang, also an immigrant, but in her case from Latvia. her parents so deeply wanted and tried to have children for a long time. And Flo's arrival into the world was a miracle to them, a source of great merits, great zichut for them. Flo was deeply close with her father and was educated from an early age at our synagogue, Anshe Chesed, from which she was confirmed when we sat on Euclid Avenue in 1943. But it was her father's activities in labor Zionism, Hishtadrut, workman's circle, that had a very strong influence on her. She identified very strongly with Zionism. In so many ways, though living in Beechwood took her east of her childhood roots here in Cleveland Heights, Florence's whole heart was in the East. If a speaker she was hearing at Temple, or listening to on a television news program, or anyone, even within remote hearing distance from her, mentioned Israel, if you were sitting next to her, you were shushed. "Shush," she'd say, as she'd perk up proud and tall to listen in to what was being said about the Jewish homeland, where her daughter Jill, Alav HaShalom, lived with her husband Yechiel, and where Maya, Imai, and Yoav, three of her five grandchildren, are here. Indeed, any mention of the three in Israel, or their cousins, Andrew and Daniel Gruns, or the great-grandchildren, Molly, Mia, Leo, Noah, Jill, and Yahli, you should only know that she admired and loved all of you, representing the generations of her family and everyone else in the world. She looked on your lives with tremendous pride and her own life with a strong dose of humility. After high school, she attended classes at Western Reserve and earned a bachelor's degree, Bachelor of Science degree in psychology from OU. During her career, Florence worked for the Cleveland Scholarship Program, assisting students with college scholarships. She was also a camp counselor in Zionist Jewish camps, and she taught in Sunday religious school at Anshe Chesed for well more than a decade. It was at OU that she met Dick, a New Jersey native, at OU as a result of the GI Bill. She told me that when Dick was living, when Dick was living at Montefiore and I was visiting him, that the two of them met at Hillel, and that although she was ahead of him in school, she wanted to make it clear that he was the older of the two of them. He was an art major, and from the first dates they shared, she loved his sense of humor, his hardworking mind, his commitment to be a caring, true companion. Indeed, the energy between the two of them changed the course of her life. Up until meeting Dick, she imagined making Aliyah after college. And although Dick did not share that dream, the two of them committed countless hours to organizations and causes in Israel, traveled there on nearly an annual basis, and were infinitely proud to be able to support groups such as Na'amat, or to be able to build a playground at Jill and Yechiel's kibbutz in Israel, and later to fund a scholarship in Jill's memory at Beechwood High School. She loved learning more about the winners of the scholarships and their pursuits after high school. When Dick was alive and well, and later, for a while after his death, Flo would enjoy traveling, especially to see grandkids in California or in Israel. We saw her at Fairmount Temple pretty much every Shabbat. She appreciated new ideas and insights, and Cantor, yes, even new songs raised from our bima. She often commented to me about Jewish values that guided her faith, our heritage in Torah, and our promise fulfilled in Eretz Yisrael. The fact that she and Dick sustained a loss that no parent should ever have to bear, the death of a child due to cancer, this did not stop her unstinted faith in the power of Jewish wisdom and ritual. She believes in the traditions, any tradition that could keep her family close. Diane and I spoke extensively earlier this week about her mom. And among the things that she shared with me about the way that Flo contributed to the life of her daughters, she described Flo as many of us remember her, funny, quiet, focused on making sure her family had what it needed. She said her mom's volunteerism had an enormous effect on Diane's own desire to work on behalf of nonprofits and causes in her home community. And Diane wrote to me yesterday an email that I would like to share now, reflecting on her sadness that she will not be able to travel to sit with us today, her disbelief about Flo's death, but also her tremendous gratitude for the acts of friends holding her up with words of support and love. Diane writes, "My mother's funeral and burial will be this Thursday, and I won't be going. It is the most difficult decision I have ever made. I haven't seen her for exactly 1 year, a whole year. That's the longest separation I can recall. And compared to the past 6 years since my father passed, when I visited her every few months, staying for at least 2 weeks, I will miss her. I will miss her terribly. While her dementia affected her memory, her sweet, good-natured, caring kindness shone bright until Friday early morning, July 31st, when she died peacefully and in her sleep. I had just spoken to her the night before, and I asked, as I always did, 'How are you doing today?' And she answered with no hesitation, 'Great.' And she was being honest, real, and positive. My mother was always so positive, never complaining or whining, always good-natured. She loved to laugh, which my father was usually responsible for, with all of his joke telling. She also enjoyed telling short jokes, as the one you've all heard. But my mother loved repeating when asked, 'Are you comfortable?' She'd reply in a Yiddish-style response with her arms and shoulders in a questioning pose, 'I make a living.' I often fed her the line purely by accident, and she'd surprise me every time with her punchline, and we'd both laugh." Diane continues, "That was my mom. And as I've read the messages I have received, friend after friend, and family too, they used many of the same words to describe her. My mother was always surrounded by family and friends, some as long back as junior high, summers at Camp Fairbond. She kept in touch with everyone so well for so long. The relationships she nurtured were the closest of friends forever. You all here know that. Whether they lived in Israel, Canada, Florida, California, Michigan, or New York, to name a few, she wrote and called and visited, and my mom reaped the benefits of having their fond attention too. These past few years, she dealt with health issues, had moved to Stone Gardens and then Helen's Place. But we spoke often. When my own health was failing, I came to the Cleveland Clinic and stayed in Cleveland for 6 months, at which time she would visit me every day, and seeing her was healing in itself. She would sit in my room in a chair where she usually slept, but knowing she was there touched me deeply. Every morning she called my hospital, asking for someone to pick her up and bring her over. I loved having her there. Later, when I returned home to California, we'd talk and she was always asking when I was coming to visit, even if she'd forgotten I was just there. Now I am struck by the fact that while I have many close friends in Cleveland, my parents are both gone. I will continue to travel there, but next time she won't be there to laugh with, have a bowl of ice cream with, watch TV from her bed where we'd snuggle, or simply be there to give and receive hugs and kisses. These are times we both cherished. Times I will miss." Dear friends, in closing, allow me to quote my contemporary colleague Joel Osserman, who worked for many years before retirement on Zionist causes, and Ola himself, who lives in Jerusalem. Rabbi Osserman wrote the following meditation, which I hope sums up the values we need most today. It begins, "A child asked, 'Tell me of life.' And the sage answered, 'Life, my child, is a mystery. We do not ask to be born, nor do we even understand the meaning of birth. We grow and experience life's pleasures and pains. We love, and slowly, oh so slowly, we come to realize that we have become, that we are. At that moment, we humble ourselves before the mystery of life and quietly say, 'Though I knew it not, I've been granted the most precious gift, the most precious gift of all. I must nurture it, delight in it, and remember it is a precious keepsake.'" Those key phrases precious keepsake gift, humbling ourselves before the mystery of life. Could there be more apt phrases to describe the dignity, the decency, and kindness of Flo Dobrin? If there are better words, I don't know them. We can learn a lot from the way Flo lived. May she rest always in peace, as together we say, Amen.
If you are able to, I invite you to please rise for our memorial prayer.
Metzay menucha nechona tachat kanafei hashechina im kedoshim utehorim kezohar harakia mazirim et nishmat Tzipora bat Moshe v'Yonina Shechar ha'le'olama Bal harachamim Yastireha v'seter k'nafav le'olamim V'yitzror v'yitzror ha'chayim Et nishmato Adonai hu nachalato Vetanuach b'shalom al mishkava V'nomach
moment when we conclude our memorial prayers, we'll invite you, if you wish, to spread a small amount of earth back into Flo's grave, assisting her with this final deed. What the rabbis called the chesed shel emet, the final kindness we can assist someone with on earth. We continue now with the words of the mourner's kaddish, these words which never mention death, but only our continued faith in life and in God's protection for all humanity. We say, Yitgadal v'yitgadash shemei rabah, ve'alma divara chirute, v'yamlich malchute, v'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chaye dechol beit Yisrael, v'agala uv'izman kari v'imru. Amen. Yehei shemei rabah me'orach l'olam ul'almei almaya, Yitbarach v'yishtabach, v'yitbo'ar v'yitramam v'yitnaseh, V'yitadar, v'yitale, v'yitalal, shemei d'kudisha, richu. Le'ela min kol birchata v'shirata, tush b'chata v'nechemata, da'meran be'alma v'yimru, amen. Yehei shlama rabba min shemayim, v'chayim alenu ve'al kol Yisrael v'yimru, amen. Ose shalom b'mramav, huya se shalom, alenu ve'al kol Yisrael, Beimru, Amen. Hamakom yinachem etchem, betoch shar of Leitzion v'Yerushalayim. May God comfort you, all of you, each of you, among the mourners of Zion and our people. Amen.
Thank you.